Good morning, tutors. Welcome, boys in year 10, 11. Welcome to our next instalment of World of Work. I'm joined today by Tom McLenican, and he is an old boy. He left the school back in 2004, and he went on to study Russian and history and did a PhD in it. He's now a senior policy advisor for the government on climate change and a CEO of an international charity that's providing access to clean water in Africa. And Tom, as normal, is going to talk for us about 7-8 minutes, something like that, about his job and his role, and then we'll take some questions. So if tutors could pop any into the chat box, I'll kind of field those towards the end. Okay, so I'll hand over to Tom now and welcome him.
Okay, thank you so much. So good morning, everyone. It's a really great pleasure to be invited to come and speak to you today, and really great to be back at Bolton School, albeit virtually. So it's 20 years since I left. And I think, you know, what I'm hoping to get from this talk is sort of that it's going to be interesting in some way for each of you, because my career has been quite varied within that time. I haven't had that kind of linear path that many of you might have. And, you know, I think one thing that, you know, I'd like to convey is that in some ways, I wish I had more of a defined idea at your kind of age of what I wanted to do. In other ways, I'm glad that I sort of kept my options open. I was acquiring, you know, sort of skills that sat across multiple different professions that I came to take in the future. What I hope is to sort of show the kind of variety that I've had throughout my career, which in itself is still, you know, defining. And I feel like only really now, 20 years on, I'm finally focusing down on one specific specialism, and have had quite a lot of variety of experiences along the way. So let me just share my screen quickly. And the one place that I'm going to start, if you can see that now, is actually from just at the end of my time at Bolton School. And one thing that was quite formative for me is I got a grant from the Scott Bolton Trust. I understand that this might have been mentioned to you yesterday in assembly or somewhere else. And this was really, really a great opportunity for me, because this gave me some funds to then travel. I took a gap year after I finished A-levels before university. And with two other students from Bolton School, we backpacked around North America for 3 months. And I think for me, it really plants the seed for the future of a want to travel and to experience different cultures and different ways of life. And for me, this was just greatly inspirational. So Mr. Newbold tells me, I think the applications close in February time or March time. So I'd really strongly consider doing that. After doing those travels, I went on to study, as Mr. Newbold said, Russian at Nottingham University. This was really inspired by my time at Bolton School. So I think Mr. Joseph, I understand, has recently retired, predicted me for my A-level history coursework in E. I think an E was my predicted grade. And in some way, that really inspired me. You know, I really wanted to prove him wrong. And he was completely right, I should say. I didn't really apply myself. I didn't really put the time or work into warrants anything, any higher predicted grade than that. But I think I went on to get a B or a C, and that was just enough to get into Nottingham University. And when I was there, I sort of really took the advantage of being able to capitalize on all the different modules available around Russian history, literature, politics, and Russian language as well. And it included also a year studying abroad, studying in Russia. Some of you on the call might be studying Russian, and while you might not have the opportunity to go to Russia itself this year because of obviously because of the conflict, but hopefully you'll get an opportunity to go to another Russian-speaking country. And having that language for me was really useful. I don't use it that regularly in my day job, but it just, as I say, really opened my horizon to, you know, to get firsthand experience of a different culture and a different form of literature and understand the world in a different way. So I studied Russian at university at Nottingham at undergraduate level. And then went on to do a master's in East European studies. So that included then studying Bulgarian language, Serbian language, and then went on to do a PhD in the Russian, in the history of Stalinism. So I wrote specifically about the relationship between science and art and philosophy in the Soviet Union. So as I sort of said at the start, you know, really keeping my options open and thinking about the interlinkages between all these different subjects and topics within history and sort to understand how they all complemented each other and things like that. So after university, I took another gap year, or as my dad calls it, gap life. So really sort of inspired to travel and experience different cultures. So I spent 2 years traveling the world, teaching English. In the photo on the left, I was actually teaching Russian in a refugee camp in Israel or Palestine in the West Bank. I was teaching in Morocco, Sudan, Vietnam, and you know, for me, I really love teaching, and but it was also just an excuse to sort of travel and see different parts of the world. I've been lucky enough now to visit, I think, 76 different countries, and still going. But you know, now that I work in the field of climate change, I'm increasingly conflicted about my own carbon footprint and have a guilt from flying as well. So, you know, that's one of my own internal conflicts. And, you know, throughout that time, it wasn't just gaining different forms of work experience around the world. I also worked as a beekeeper. I worked on an olive farm, and also for an environmental NGO. I also sort of traveled as well. So in the right hand picture, for example, visiting Everest Base Camp and doing a trek up there. So again, you get these kind of opportunities through the school, I'm sure, of sort of trekking and different forms of active kind of travel. So again, I'd capitalize on that as much as possible. But it was 3 years ago that I guess I really started my career in earnest. I joined the civil service. So I managed to successfully apply to the civil service fast stream. You might have heard of this through the careers guidance that you receive at Bolton School. So there's a total of 15 different fast streams that you can apply to. And I've given some examples on the slide here, you know, different career paths that you can take. The application process is very competitive. There's up to 8 or 9 different steps in the process. And for me, it took a couple of years actually applying to be successful. So if it's something that you want to consider, I'd, you know, start thinking about it now. Research it, look at the different kind of skills that they're looking for, maybe look at what different fast stream might be of interest to you, because there is huge variety. And the way that it works is that you join one of these streams for 3 or 4 years, you get a variety of different experiences, you spend between 6 or 12 months in different departments, so you move around quite a lot. A lot of the roles you're working internationally as well. So for me, I was probably most orientated or attracted to the diplomatic fast stream. I didn't quite get the in on that one in terms of the application. So I joined the project delivery fast stream, and that led me to the Department for Transport, where I started a role in project delivery, but very quickly moved on to focus on climate change. So obviously such a huge issue in the UK. It's one of the main priorities for the government. And the UK is one of the sort of the leading, let's say, large economic countries internationally for climate change. Although I think all of us recognize that there's still a long way to go in terms of strengthening those kind of policies, especially around transport. So what you can see here is the trajectory of emissions by sector in the UK, and transport is now the largest emitting sector. So that's sort of tail emissions from our cars, the powering of the railways, as I said before, flying and international shipping and things like that. So my role is focused on reducing the emissions from transport, looking particularly around the build of new the road network and different forms of infrastructure and things like HS2. Alongside that, I do almost a second job. So sometimes it feels like I do two jobs at once. So luckily, one good thing about the civil service, it gives me a good amount of flexibility. So through my travels, I also ended up in Uganda and met some friends there. And we ended up co-forming this charity called Equal Aqua Uganda. And this charity seeks to provide access to water, sanitation, hygiene for communities in Uganda and East Africa. And what we do is we try and find groups that are facing the greatest inequalities in access to water. So that could be inequalities like income, or geography or gender or status. So we work a lot with refugees, for example. And this is particularly important in Uganda, and our programs are particularly orientated towards women and girls. So the average household in Uganda spends 2 hours collecting water, and that's a burden that's carried, literally carried, by women and girls. And that's time that could or should be spent in school, working, playing. So it's hugely detrimental to people's development. So we try and address that inequality and try and provide equal access to water and sanitation. So I know that I'm probably going over time a little bit, but just to summarize, you know, we're a team of now 31 people across 11 different countries throughout the world. So it's actually just a great pleasure working with this international group. And while our projects have focused on Uganda to date, we're looking now to sort of to neighbouring countries as well. And we're also looking for more volunteers as well. I don't know if there's any kind of sort of apprenticeship programme within Bolton School, but maybe, you know, happy to explore with you opportunities for that. Happy to answer any questions that you might have about any of my journey, which feels like a little bit meandering, but hopefully there's something in there that's interesting to you or inspirational to you in some kind of way. So thank you so much.
That's great. Thanks, Tom. One question I was just going to ask, just to start off, and if tutors want to pop any questions in the chat, that would be great, is the civil service itself, it looks like it's a company that you can obviously have a lot of kind of opportunities for. Is that one of the things you'd recommend about it, that your career can take different directions?
Absolutely. I mean, the amount of lateral movement, so your ability once you're in the civil service to then move to different departments, different kind of roles, is one of the things that attracted it most to me, but I think is also something that you consider. I think it's similar in a lot of ways to a lot of professions or organizations. Once you've got the foot in the door, then you've really got the opportunity for that kind of flexibility. You know, if you're able to demonstrate you've got the skills that can apply to multiple roles, be it, you know, critical analysis, forming an argument, communicating, presenting, you know, and having sort of that reliability in your own performance, then it gives you great opportunity to move around. I think that's one of the things that attracted most to me, and I think that's why you might want to consider it as at least, you know, one of the graduate scheme options that could be available to you.
Mm-hmm. I've got questions, which one's just appeared in the chat. Mr. Kettlesforms will ask, this is not necessarily your personal self, Tom, but what is the earning potential within the civil service?
Good question. So the graduate scheme that I described, you start on something like £28,000 to £32,000. So it's fairly, you know, representative of the normal kind of entry wage that you would receive for that kind of graduate scheme. Maybe slightly less, actually, you might say, than if you went to sort of the likes of Deloitte, or, you know, the big consultancy companies. But what you do have in the civil service is the ability to progress quite quickly. So once you've completed the grad scheme, which is about 3 to 4 years, you would achieve what would call be grade 7. So the wage you would achieve that receive at that grade is around about £54,000-£55,000 per year. So, you know, for someone who's 24, 25 years old after completing the scheme, that's, I think, a pretty competitive wage.
Yeah.
And as I say, after that, you've got the opportunity then to progress every 1 year, every 2 years, in your career as well. So, I wouldn't say that it has necessarily the highest wage that you might get in the private sector for a lot of roles, at least at the start, but you can progress quite quickly and you get a lot of other benefits within the civil service that you wouldn't get elsewhere. Mm-hmm. So for me, I described it gives me that flexibility. I'm able to run a charity on the side. I can choose my working pattern in terms of number of days. You get more days, annual leave and holiday and other kind of benefits each year as well. So it maybe offers a bit more of a holistic package as well, which might be more attracted to you and your circumstances.
Brilliant. The roles you've got there, Tom, to do with the climate change and the access to water, are they something you're particularly passionate about as well?
Yeah, I mean, I do the charity. I'm the CEO for the charity for free. I don't take a wage. We're all volunteers, you know. No one's forcing me to do it. I'm doing it for a passion of, you know, trying to make a difference for that cause, you know, sort of seeing firsthand the issues people have around water sanitation. But actually, it's more on a personal level, just the enjoyment of working as part of this team, having this kind of project. Again, you know, relating back to my experience with the Scott Bolton Trust, it gives me the opportunity to interact with sort of different people from around the world and different cultures and things like that. And the two things for me are complementary as well. So, you know, with the charity, we also look at sustainability and climate change and things like that, which is the focus of my job as well. But having the two things gives me that element of variety. I saw the question in the chat. No, you don't need to work in London. I do live and work in London, but each department has a different, at least one different office in different places throughout the country. And you can work mostly virtually as well. So the deal in my department is you have to do 2 days in the office per week, and then you can do 3 days virtually as well. So again, it gives you that kind of flexibility. So there are offices in Manchester and other places in North Manchester as well for different kind of departments as well. So so again, gives you that flexibility to live and work where you're currently based, or opportunity to move around the country as well.
Just got one final question, Tom. What was the best country you visited and why on your travels?
Oh, it's so hard to choose. Really, really hard to choose. So, you know, for me, I something about Vietnam really, really sat with me. It's among all the places I've visited, it's got the most breathtaking natural beauty. The food is absolutely unbelievable. Sort of really sort of fresh fish recently caught that I haven't sort of tasted those kind of flavors anywhere else in the world. And like the same with everywhere, most importantly, is just the people, really. I mean, everywhere I've been, I'd say overwhelmingly my impression is that people fundamentally are nice and friendly, and that I've felt quite safe, actually, which is not the impression that you might get, you know, sort of watching the news every day and things like that. And while you do have to be careful, I do get a feeling of safety. But the people in Vietnam really sort of stood out as quite welcoming, and, you know, feel like you can make friends instantly when arriving there.
That's great. Thanks, Tom. What I might do is take any more questions in the chat and just email them to you, if that'd be all right, Tom, and send them back to the form with the replies. We know Tom's got a meeting he's got to go to as well, and it is nearly a minute till lesson one. So we're just going to finish it there. So thanks very much again, Tom. And I know the tutors will be thank you in the room. I can't see them physically, but they will be here. And if they could now leave tutors, that'd be great. And send the boys off to period one. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.